This is part 9 and the final part of my BMW M52 rebuild series. As we get started here, you can see I'm installing a new water pump. The O-ring on these pumps needs to be lubed a little bit, but of course I didn't happen to have any coolant handy, so I just used a little bit of silicone paste lube. I've also noticed in the past that these nuts can get a little crusty, so I usually replace them. But these were in surprisingly good shape, so I reused them. Don't quote me on the torque spec, but I believe it's like 10 newton meters or 88 inch pounds, which is pretty much the standard torque for a M6 fastener. And if you're wondering what that yellow mark is on the thermostat housing, that's actually an R that dripped a little bit. And that was my reminder to replace that thermostat housing because although it was brand new, I managed to crack it on installation. So I eventually did replace that. So I just did the first turn through after timing the engine and tightening everything up, vanos is in, etc. I wanted to just turn the crank, go through basically two full revolutions, watch the cam rotate effectively one time, come back around to the TDC point, and then I made some marks. I don't have the flywheel on right now, but I made some marks, just pen marks, on the crank and then the rear main seal housing, and I just looked for those marks to align. And they did. I came back up here, looked at this, and then of course I used my TDC ruler, which at the time showed me that I was at TDC. Actually, it's like that. There you go. The line down here means TDC, and that's correct too. So. That looks good, but the first time I tried to turn it through with just a wrench about this size, nothing huge, but 22 millimeter socket on the crank bolt, it was very hard to turn. In fact, I got a little concerned and I stopped turning it because I was like, oh, okay, do I have something too tight in here? Is there something catching or grabbing? And then I realized I had the spark plugs in. So I was fighting compression. So I removed the spark plugs, and after that it was a lot easier. So now I'm gonna put the spark plugs back in, which is made very easy with one of these rubber sockets. And I like to hand tighten them so I don't cross thread. It doesn't take that much longer. In or out of the car is a good idea. And I believe it or not, and despite everything I'm replaced on this engine, I'm actually reusing a spark plug since they only had about 30,000 miles on them. And I have data from several spark plug replacements that the Platinums last easily. They're good for 75,000 miles. Officially, they're good for 100,000. And I've run them, I think, as high as 75 or 77, something like that, and there was no noticeable or significant degradation. I felt that they could have lasted until 100,000 miles. So at least in this particular case, the manufacturer's recommendation for 100,000 mile spark plug changes is actually not bad. When this engine was first delivered in 98, it came with copper electrode plugs, and those were good for at most 30,000 miles. So I actually went through a few sets of those before BMW decided to supersede those and start recommending Platinums. So these are like almost like aircraft spark plugs. They're about $22 a piece. So there was no point in replacing them. They had that much life left in them. Plus, all I did was clean up the threads and very, very lightly oil them, because there's no oil, normally there's a little bit of oil or whatever on the threads, just from normal operation. So actually more carbon and buildup and stuff, but there's usually a little bit of touch of oil, and or at least they're not dry. But this head is a brand new head, so the threads are a little dry, so I just applied the very, very, very light film, almost imperceptible film. I actually put oil on the threads and then wiped it off with a towel and then blew it dry with compressed air. All right, so they're all in. All right,
22 foot-pounds. Okay, spark plugs are in.
Here I'm installing the intake cam position sensor. If it looks new, that's just a coincidence. I did replace it about 2 years ago. And of course, there was no need to replace it again. If memory serves, the fastener is an M6. It requires just a drop of blue Loctite on it. And here you can see I'm threading it in by hand because I don't want to cross thread or potentially snap it off. Torque on the fastener is very low. I think it's only like 4 or 5 foot-pounds, and it is important to use a torque wrench so you don't snap it. One thing to check before the Vanos solenoid is installed is to verify that that piston is fully oiled and slides smoothly in and out of that housing bore. This was necessary in my case because I rebuilt the Vanos housing and used mineral spirits to clean it up, so there just wasn't enough oil there, and I found that the piston tended to bind. So naturally I put some oil on it. There is a torque spec for the Vanos solenoid, but I just used a wrench and tightened it by feel. So here's the new oil filter housing. I previously indicated that this appears to be a newer casting version. Mine, I think, had an earlier letter on this, so I believe that's the casting version. And of course, it comes with a new gasket, but these are kind of known to fail and require 4 to 5 hours to fix. So I'm upgrading, or at least attempting to upgrade, to a Viton seal. And the hope is that this will last a lot longer than the other seals, but I will be saving these seals. I actually have another one. I bought another one before I thought I was going to buy this, so I actually have 2 spare seals now. And I'm going to try this seal out, see how it works. During the painting process, I managed to mask off most of the mounting bosses on the block. One of the mounting bosses of the oil filter housing, the one shown on the bottom left, was not masked, however, because there was an alignment dowel installed in it, and I found it basically impossible to get masking tape around that alignment dowel or over the dowel and to actually stick with the block, so I just let it go. But as I was test fitting the oil filter housing, that dowel actually came out of the block, so I knew that it was easily removed at that point. And so I did pull it out and then decided to clean up that boss with a Rolock disc chucked in my die grinder. The bolts on the ground are the original bolts, and you can see they are a couple different sizes. And the new bolts are installed in the filter housing. The easiest way to make sure you don't put the bolts in the wrong place is to insert them all in the housing and just verify that they extend beyond the rear face of the housing approximately the same amount. I think it's really important to hand thread the bolts on the oil filter housing. This is because the housing tends to pivot somewhat on the gasket before it's fully compressed. And as a result, it seems likely or more likely that the bolts would cross thread. The other thing I noticed was that when I was screwing these bolts in, even by hand,
And especially when I started to tighten them with a torque wrench, they just didn't feel right. And again, I think this is due to the gasket compressing over time. These bolts seemed to take forever to reach their final torque, but eventually the torque wrench clicked on all 6 bolts and I considered the job done. Although the housing is shown here without a filter, it does in fact come with a filter and a new black cap, etc. Basically ready to install. I knew I was getting close to the end of the build when I realized I was doing something so trivial as install a new oil filter and torquing the cap to spec. And the last thing I had to do before installing the valve cover was to clean and reinstall that black cover over the intake camshaft. That was actually an odd piece because it looked like it was clean at first glance, but I kept scrubbing and scrubbing and scrubbing, and with mineral spirits and degreaser, dirt just kept coming off of it. I had the same problem with the valve cover. I scrubbed this thing forever. I used mineral spirits, Zep degreasing fluid, everything I could try. I let it soak, and no matter what I did, I just could not remove all of that crust. But ultimately, I cleaned it up and installed the valve cover gaskets. Next step, of course, was to install the valve cover. Naturally, before I did this, I applied some RTV to the half moons and also to the seam between the head and the vanos. I have to point out that my DIY on this subject shows a lot more RTV than is strictly necessary. When it comes to RTV, less is more. On my engine, a lot of the nuts and washers used to install or mount the valve cover to the head were quite rusty, so I happened to buy new ones. Of course, I had also bought the little rubber seals separately, and then I realized that BMW only sells the nuts and washers with new seals. So now I have an extra set of seals. With the valve cover tightened down to the head and the spark plugs checked one last time for final torque, the next step was to install the ignition coils. If you look carefully on the top of the valve cover, you may notice two braided bonding wire straps. These straps are actually supposed to be installed at the front and the rear of the valve cover. But you can see one of them is installed incorrectly between the spark plugs for 2 and 3. I eventually figured this out when I tried to install the harness because a bonding wire that comes straight out of the harness is intended for that binding post. As you can see, I've labeled each coil with a number. I wound up doing that about 10 years ago during my first DIY in the engine bay, in which I replaced the valve cover gaskets and the spark plugs. I think it's really helpful to have them labeled so that if you ever have to do any troubleshooting and swap coils, you can better keep track of them. It was also during that DIY 10 years ago that I replaced the spark plug electrode boots. At the time, the engine had about 125,000 miles on it, and I found the electrodes within the boots somewhat scorched or burnt. But strangely enough, I noticed that the boots that I replaced 10 years ago, which now at this point had over 125,000 miles on them in service, were in absolutely perfect shape, so I didn't bother to replace them. Now the electrode boots actually snap into place on the coils, but they don't snap into place on the spark plugs themselves. They just are kind of spring-loaded. There's a spring down there, and you have to push the ignition coil down and then install the bolts. And as I'm wrapping up coil number 6 here, you can see that I'm installing one of the bolts and then putting the bonding strap under the other bolt before tightening it down. Naturally, I installed the bonding strap on cylinder number 1 in the same way. The next step was to install the ignition coil harness. I'm not sure if it's obvious here, but as I insert the connectors into the coils, I'm actually kind of meshing them with those retaining clips as well, since the connectors actually have to be pushed in as those retaining clips are pushed down simultaneously. I'm not just pushing the connector in and then pushing down the retaining clip. That simply won't work. To wrap up the harness installation, I'm taking that brown wire and tying it to the binding post on the valve cover. That brown wire is a ground wire and is essential for proper functioning of the ignition. And the final step is to, of course, torque all the coils down to 10 Newton meters or 88 inch pounds. So here's a close-up flyby of the freshly installed coils, and you can see where that brown wire connects to that binding post between cylinders 2 and 3. And finally, this is the completed engine, fully assembled and ready for delivery to my technician. Everything you see here is either new or refurbished. You can also see I've applied blue tape to every hole, every connector, every hose to make sure no dirt gets in where it doesn't belong. And for those that think I'm being a little paranoid here, remember I actually did have to put this in the back of the pickup truck and drive it over to my dealer, and I didn't really have any means of effectively wrapping it, so I pretty much just put it on the pallet as is and took it over a couple days later. A couple days later, I brought the engine and all the other driveline related parts to my technician and he installed them. Before I roll this clip, I just want to point out that we had been just prior to this turning over the engine with the fuel pump fuse removed so that we could help prime the oil pump. Unfortunately, during all that cranking, we did not notice the oil pressure light go out. So we decided at this point to reinstall the fuse and turn the key. And this is what happened. So that's a wrap on this series. If you've made it this far, congratulations. You're obsessed with the M52 almost as much as I am. If you found this series helpful or at least entertaining, please head over to my blog and throw a few bucks in my tip jar. Thanks a lot.